If you have his word, and I hope you do, let me invite you to open with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 6. And feel free to use table of contents if you need to. And let me invite you also to pull out the notes you received in the worship guide when you came in. There's notes there and an insert there that are going to guide our time together tonight. Just as a reminder, we are in part two of the cross in Christian sexuality, and we've labeled this week's sermon and last week's sermon PG-13 because we are talking specifically and explicitly about sexuality and sexual sin. So I had some people tell me last week that they thought it was going to be more graphic and they wished their children had been here. Had others tell me that they wished their children were not here. So I don't know what to tell you. Like, you look down at the notes there, including the insert in your worship guide, you're going to get a pretty good idea where we're going. So if you'd rather not get some of the questions, have some of the conversations that might come from your children at this point, then feel free to go ahead and take your children to children's ministry stuff. You can go out in the lobby and they can direct you from there. Or if you're listening to this via podcast with your kids in the car, just be warned. So, and if you're visiting with us tonight, whether you're a Christian from another church or maybe you're not a Christian, I want you to know that we don't talk about masturbation and pornography every week. So I know some of you are visiting, you're looking at it like, honey, great, we visited Brook Hills on masturbation night. So that's where we're, if you're here, let's just go ahead and get some of these words out there. Maybe it'll relieve, well, it kind of creates some of the tension. I don't know if it relieves it, but it's, well, welcome to that night here at Brook Hills. We're walking through the Bible. This book of 1 Corinthians was written as a letter to a church in a sex-crazed city called Corinth. And there are so many parallels to the church in a sex-crazed culture that surrounds us. So just to recap where we were last week. So the central exhortation, this passage we're in, 1 Corinthians 6, 12 through 20, the central exhortation is flee sexual immorality. So let's go ahead and read this passage again just to make sure we have the context. And just so you know, this is kind of our base text tonight, but we're going to zoom out from here most of our time together to see what the whole Bible teaches us about sexuality. But this is Paul specifically speaking to the church at Corinth to show these new believers an entirely new sexual ethic that revolves not around self-gratification, but God glorification. So follow along with me. And since we started last week in verse 9, we'll start there again. So 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9. The Word of God says, "Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who practice homosexuality, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. And such were some of you, but you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. All things are lawful for me, but not all things are helpful. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be dominated by anything. Food is meant for the stomach and the stomach for food, and God will destroy both one and the other. The body is not meant for sexual immorality, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. And God raised the Lord and will also raise us up by his power. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? Shall I then take the members of Christ and make them members of a prostitute? Never. Or do you not know that he who is joined to a prostitute becomes one body with her? For as it is written, the two will become one flesh. But he who is joined to the Lord becomes one spirit with him. Flee from sexual immorality. Every other sin a person commits is outside the body, but the sexually immoral person sins against his own body. Or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God? You are not your own, for you were bought with a price. So glorify God in your body." So the central exhortation there in verse 18 is clear. You might underline your Bible, put a star around it, flee from sexual immorality. Don't reason with sexual immorality. Don't rationalize it. Run from it. Flee it as fast as you can.
And last week we talked about what sexual immorality is. It's in your notes, the biblical clarification. When the Bible says to flee sexual immorality, the Bible is saying to flee any and all sexual activity outside of marriage between a man and a woman. So this is the word for sexual immorality in 1 Corinthians 6:18, porneia. Porneia is a general term that involves any sexual activity outside of marriage between a man and a woman. So that includes any and all fornication, prostitution, pornography, adultery, homosexual activity, any and all sexual thinking, desiring, looking, touching, speaking, acting outside of marriage between a man and a woman. All of these things are sin, and we are to run from them. In a helpful book on holiness that I quoted from last week, Kevin DeYoung said the simplest way to understand porneia is to think about the things that would make you furious and heartbroken if you found out someone was doing them with your husband or your wife. So when you think sexual immorality, think any kind of sexual activity outside of marriage between a man and a woman. And that's the key. This is not at all to say that sex is bad, but that sex is good within the boundaries that God has designed for sex. So you had Corinthians then, just like Americans today, who were saying, well, it's two consenting adults. Like, what's the problem? This is what my body was made for. I was created this way. Just like I eat because I'm hungry, I do this sexually because of my biology. So who are you to say this is sin? And what makes it sin? It's just who I am. And Paul says, no, it's not just who you are. Your body is not just about biology. Your body is much more valuable than that. Your body has been created and designed by God for your good and for His glory. And so it's wise to listen to what God says about your body. And God, we're talking God, says as clearly as it's possible to say, sex is for marriage between a man and a woman, and any sexual activity outside of marriage between a man and a woman is sin. It's sexual immorality, and we should flee it. Now, to most people in our culture, in this city, in our country, this is outlandish and offensive to call these things sin. To call fornication, homosexual activity, even adultery sin is seen by many as narrow-minded, arrogant, even hateful. I mentioned last week, and we in no way planned this, but it's just obviously providential that we would be in this text on the two Sundays surrounding landmark court decisions in our country that were announced this last week. The Supreme Court of our country remanding the decision of the Ninth Circuit in the Proposition 8 case in California, which effectively paves the way for the legalization of same-sex marriage in California, and then striking down DOMA, the Defense of Marriage Act, as unconstitutional, which not only federally acknowledges same-sex marriage in various states across our country, but essentially paves the way for constitutional rights to same-sex marriage in every state in the days ahead. And so I put at the top of your notes just a few exhortations that I would give us as the church, springing from this text and all of Scripture in light of what happened in our country this last week. So how are we to respond to what just happened in the Supreme Court? Well, first, I would say to us as a church, as a faith family, that it is good to be grieved about the degradation and supposed redefinition of marriage that took place this last week. It's good to be grieved. Now, I'm not saying that grief is an enjoyable emotion in and of itself, and I'm not saying that this decision by the Supreme Court was a good decision. Instead, what I'm saying is that if you're grieved by what happened this last week, then that's a good thing. And if you're not grieved by what happened this last week, that's probably not a good thing. Maybe even a bad thing. The decision made by the Supreme Court of our country leads our country further down the line of fundamentally going against the law of God and the design of God for marriage. To use language directly from the minority opinion in that decision in the court written by Judge Scalia, this decision undercuts an aspect of marriage that has been unquestioned in our society for most of its existence. Indeed, has been unquestioned in virtually all societies for virtually all of human history. In the beginning, Genesis 2:24, God designed marriage as the one flesh union of a man and a woman together. And God was not haphazard in designing marriage that way. He designed it that way for a reason. Ephesians 5 tells us God designed marriage specifically so that we would have a picture of His great love for us in Christ's sacrificial love for the church. That's why we have marriage in the first place. And so to see that picture undercut by Supreme Court is heartbreaking because it goes against the design of God and the picture of the gospel and the glory of God in marriage. So we should be grieved by this. But not just by this decision, by the degradation of marriage across our culture, even in the church. So yes, this week was significant, but you put the Supreme Court decision completely aside. We need to be grieved over all the ways that marriage has been and is being minimized and distorted in our culture, our country, and in the church. Through a divorce culture, through a singles culture that postpones marriage longer and longer and longer as if it's not that important. Marriage is important. It's extremely important. And we need to be grieved over anything that threatens the institution of marriage in our lives, in our families, in the church, and in our country. Second, it's right to be concerned about religious liberty in our country. Now, my aim here is not to be an alarmist. But the reality is clear. The majority opinion written by Justice Kennedy in this case seemed to assume rather strongly that opposition to same-sex marriage is rooted in animus, in hatred. Justices Roberts and Scalia both argued in their dissents that the majority court was painting supporters of traditional marriage as bigots and literally enemies of the human race. How could they, back in the 90s, come up with this Defense of Marriage Act? And the answer that the majority opinion gave is that they were acting with malice, with the purpose to disparage and to injure same-sex couples. Traditional marriage supporters sought to demean, to impose inequality, to impose a stigma, to deny people equal dignity, to brand gay people as unworthy, and to humiliate their children. That's striking language that was used this last week to categorize anybody who supports biblical marriage. And as a result, I am convinced that there will be ramifications of this decision when it comes to religious liberties and challenges ahead for churches and Christian institutions and Christian business owners and leaders who hold to a biblical picture of marriage. We've already seen this in places like Washington or Massachusetts, where after same-sex marriage was legalized, Catholic Charities, one of the foremost, if not the foremost, institutions working for foster care and adoption in that state, was virtually shut down because they refused to place foster or adoptive children with families that consist of same-sex marriages. And that's just one example. There are a variety of others. The point is, I think we'd be foolish not to realize that the proclamation of God's word and living out the implications of God's word in our country is going to be harder, not easier, in the coming days. And I put Romans 13 in parentheses there because, yes, we submit to our government and its purpose under God for the common good. At the same time, in the same vein as Peter and John in Acts chapter 4, we cannot help but to speak this word no matter what it costs us. In the words of a Manhattan declaration that I and a host of other religious leaders signed not long ago, we will not bend to any rule purporting to force us to bless immoral sexual partnerships, treat them as marriages or the equivalent, or refrain from proclaiming the truth as we know it about morality and immorality and marriage and the family. We will fully and ungrudgingly render to Caesar what is Caesar's, but under no circumstances will we render to Caesar what is God's. So, third, now keep going with me here. It is imperative, church, to be loving toward our gay and lesbian friends and neighbors. We must be careful, church, not to look at our gay and lesbian friends and neighbors as enemies who are part of some conspiracy against us. They are friends and neighbors who are seeking a way that seems right to them. And just as they are turning aside from God's way, we are all prone to do the same. We talked about this last week. We are all sexual sinners, heterosexual, homosexual alike, and we all need a Savior. So love your gay and lesbian neighbors, not as your enemies, but as your friends, and lead them patiently to see the love of God for them and the desire of God for their good. Not just now, but forever. Last reaction. It is wise to be confident. It is wise to be confident in the resiliency of marriage Matthew 19, Jesus said, marriage has been around since the beginning. Revelation 19, marriage will be around until the end. Marriage is a picture that will represent our union with Christ in heaven forever. So don't worry about whether or not marriage is going to make it. The reality is we don't look to any court or any state legislature to define marriage. God has defined marriage, and God's definition of it cannot be eradicated by a vote or a decision of 9 Supreme Court justices. There is a supreme judge who has defined marriage once and for all. So be confident in the resiliency of marriage and in the opportunity for the gospel. There is no question that this decision, this movement in our country, presents a huge opportunity for gospel witness. As spiritual darkness engulfs the picture of marriage in our culture, spiritual light is going to shine all the brighter in the picture of a husband who lovingly lays down his life to sacrifice for his wife, and a wife who joyfully and gladly follows the loving leadership of her husband in a way that reflects Christ's love for the church. Now, God's design for marriage is far more breathtaking and far more satisfying than anything we can create on our own. So let's give ourselves to His design. Let's let this moment drive us in this room to revive our marriages so that the glory of God in the gospel might be all the more clear through us in the coming days. And it's wise to be confident in the sovereignty of our God. Ladies and gentlemen, Jesus is still alive. And Jesus is still sovereign over all history, including what happened in the United States of America this last week. Things are not out of control. Ultimately, things are completely in control of the sovereign hands of a God who is working all things together for the good of those who love Him. And remember, biblical Christianity, throughout its history, biblical Christianity has always thrived most when it has been seen in sharp contrast to the culture around it. It was certainly true in Corinth, and that's why God in His Word called the church then and there, and that's why God in His Word is calling the church here and now in this room to take extreme measures to flee sexual immorality. I'll go ahead and warn you, much of what we're going to talk about tonight is going to sound entirely extreme to many, maybe even most of you, even among Christians in this room. But I hope you will see this in the backdrop of the way the gospel distinctly compels us to live in this culture, so that under the sovereignty of God, you will carry out this word with courage, no matter what it costs you, knowing that though these days are difficult, the opportunities for the gospel in and through your life are greater than ever. So, let's pick up where we left off last week. My goal last week, starting in 1 Corinthians 6, then branching out in all of Scripture, was to see sexuality in light of the gospel and God's good design for sexuality. So we talked a good bit about how God designed sex to be relational, covenantal, intimate, fruitful, selfless, complex, complementary, all of these things for our good, for His glory. So flowing from that, I thought it would be helpful to give you a list here of clear sexual prohibitions in Scripture. So things in Scripture that God specifically says, don't do this. Because I think this will help shed some light on how we flee, what are we fleeing when it comes to sexual immorality. And it also help us to answer some questions below that sometimes we start to view as gray areas. So we saw how God designed sexual activity to take place in the context of marriage between a man and a woman. And as a result, we see clear prohibitions in Scripture, like, number one, no sex outside of marriage. Marriage is the God-given boundary defining the limits of sex. Marriage is like fire. You keep it in the fireplace, or sex is like fire. You keep it in the fireplace of marriage, it's a great thing. You take it out of the fireplace in the rest of the house, it's a really bad thing. Sex outside of marriage is sin, always, whether it happens before, during, after marriage. The Bible is clear on this. There's no question. There's no discussion. Old Testament says it. Jesus says it. New Testament reiterates it. No sex outside of marriage. And realize why this is. Remember last week we said that sex is covenantal? Why? Think about it. The Bible teaches that marriage is a covenant that establishes a relationship between a man and a woman who commit themselves to one another. And like every other covenant in the Bible, marriage as a covenant has a sign. Think about it. The sign of God's covenant with Noah was a what? It was a rainbow. The sign of God's new covenant with His church is baptism, just like we celebrated earlier with Rebecca. This picture, this sign that represents the covenant between Christ and us. So when you enter into the marriage covenant, what's the sign of that covenant? And the sign is literally this physical, one flesh act of sex. So don't miss it. Sex is not just reward for getting married. That'd be like saying baptism is your reward for becoming a Christian. No, sex is the sign of this marriage covenant. So having sex with your wife or your husband, both that first time after you're married and then every subsequent time after that, having sex is a sign before God that you're in covenant with this person. And as a result, having sex outside of marriage makes a mockery of that covenant and misses the whole point of sex in the first place. So no sex outside of marriage. Second sexual prohibition in Scripture, no sexual worship. Sex is good, but sex is not God. And throughout the history of God's people, Deuteronomy 23, Exodus 32, 1 Corinthians 10, we see God's people falling into the trap of worshiping sex. It's happening today across our culture. I'm convinced this is part of what's at the root of so much that's going on in our culture right now. So many people thinking, if only I have sexual freedom in this way or that way, then I will be happy. But this too is a false god. It's a broken cistern that cannot hold water. So let's be there when they see the broken cistern doesn't hold water to say, there is one who satisfies. And satisfaction is not found in this gift. It's found in the giver of the gift. Sex is good, but it's not God. No sexual worship. Third, no sexual prostitution or violence. No sexual prostitution, clear in Leviticus 19, Deuteronomy 23, Proverbs 6. And then Scripture speaks clearly against all kinds of violence, including sadism, masochism, any kind of spousal abuse. God has not designed sex to be hurtful. He's designed sex to mirror the love relationship between Christ and his church, Ephesians 5, which sacrifices for one another's good. No sexual prostitution or violence. Fourth, no homosexual activity. We talked about this last week. You have to deny Scripture altogether to miss this. Leviticus 18, Romans 1, the whole of Scripture that not only condemns homosexual activity, but never once exalts any kind of sexual activity that's not heterosexual between a man and a woman in marriage. It is impossible to biblically justify homosexual activity. Many try to do it and all ultimately fail, twisting God's word to make it say something that it does not say. If you're going to say that homosexual activity is good before God, then you have to say that the Bible is either dangerous or deficient altogether. We talked about that last week. Fifth, no sex with animals, relatives, or children. I hope all these are obvious, and I made brief mention of pedophilia last week as an illustration to show the parallels between attempts to justify that sin and our attempts to justify all sorts of other sexual sin in our lives. And I just want to come back to that briefly, because I know that there are some, maybe many of you in this room, who experienced sexual abuse when you were a child. And I can only imagine the wounds that some of this may bring up in your heart and your mind. So it's not in your notes, but I want to send you to 1 Peter 5:7 and exhort you to cast your cares on Christ, because Christ cares deeply for you. And I want to encourage you to go to him for healing in your heart. And at the same time, I want you to know that if you don't have someone who you can walk with through that healing process, we would love, as elders and deacons, members in this faith family, to walk with you through that journey. You are not alone. So please feel free to let me or Pastor Jim know after the worship gathering. There's someone over here in the access corner to my right, your left. We would love to walk alongside you in your hurt. Next, the Bible clearly says no sexual lust, which is having wrong sexual desires for others. Jesus is clear. Matthew 5, everyone who looks at a woman with lustful intent has already committed adultery with her in his heart. It is wrong for you to think about, entertain the thought of, or desire in any way sex with someone who's not your wife or your husband. That's lust. And then no sexual immodesty, which is provoking wrong sexual desires in others. This is huge. Men and women across this room, it is wrong for you to provoke sexual desires in someone else who is not your wife or your husband. Romans 14, 21, don't cause your brother to stumble. Specifically speaking to women, the Bible says, 1 Timothy 2, 9 and 10, women should adorn themselves in respectable apparel with modesty and self-control, with what is proper for women who profess godliness with good works. In other words, women, dress modestly, not in a way that draws attention to yourself sexually. This is so huge. In our culture, let's just be honest, we are extremely loose when it comes to what women wear. Skin-tight clothes, low necklines, short dresses, short skirts, short shorts, goes on. It's the norm among us. And it falls dreadfully short of God's standards for us. And I say this in general, and then particularly when it comes to even to the gathering of the church. The Bible says to many women in the church, and with all due respect, even to sisters in this room right now, the ways some of you are dressing around your brothers are at best a distraction from honoring God, and at worst an attempt, whether you realize it or not, to seduce men in this church into sin. The Bible says, don't do it. For the sake of your brothers, for the sake of your body, dress modestly. And don't miss what 1 Timothy's saying there. It's not saying don't adorn yourself with anything. It's not wrong to adorn yourself. You say, well, what am I supposed to adorn myself with? Not with physical immodesty that draws attention to you, but adorn yourself with good works that draw attention to God. And think about who you're competing with for attention. I urge you, church, no sexual immodesty. For your good, for our good, ultimately for God's glory, to whom we want to point attention. So lower the standards go in the culture around us, we think, well, the church just goes down. As long as we're above that, we're okay. Don't buy it. Don't buy it. No sexual immodesty. Similarly, the Bible says no sexual allurement, including inappropriate emotional attachment outside of marriage. Now, the scriptures that I've listed here specifically pertain to a woman alluring a man, but this could obviously go either way and often involves both ways. So, emotional attachment is often the gateway for many people, particularly women, but I think both men and women. It's the gateway into a sexual affair. You remember those feelings that you had when you were first attracted to someone. You thought about that person all the time. You look forward to every interaction with that person, even if it was something small. You just wanted to be around them. You were emotionally attached to them. But then, after time goes on, years of marriage sometimes even, and the shine off the romance begins to fade as you watch them brush their teeth on a daily basis. And the reality is no man, no woman can consistently measure up to that sweaty palm butterfly feeling that you once got. And so another man or another woman can come along and he or she can start to make you feel like your wife or your husband once made you feel. And so you find yourself thinking about that other person, beginning to look forward to interaction with that other person. And slowly you start to think about and turn to that other person in the way that you're supposed to think about and turn to your husband or your wife. And you rationalize it, thinking, this is an emotional attachment. It's just enjoying time with somebody else. What's so wrong with that? And maybe it's the kind of thing your soul is starved for because you're not getting it in marriage. And you think it's not physical, so it's not harmful, when the reality is the more you become attached and your thoughts and emotions, the more you will find yourself wanting to attach to that person physically. You read both Proverbs 5 and Proverbs 7, and you see an emotional attachment that eventually leads to a physical relationship. And I just want you to listen to how the author describes it. In this case, it's a woman alluring a man emotionally. Listen to this. With much seductive speech, she persuades him. With her smooth talk, she compels him. All at once he follows her, as an ox goes to the slaughter, or as a stag is caught fast till an arrow pierces its liver, as a bird rushes into a snare, he does not know that it will cost him his life. Oh, sons, listen to me and be attentive to the words of my mouth. Let not your heart turn aside to her ways. Do not stray into her paths, for many a victim has she laid low, and all her slain are a mighty throng. Her house is the way to Sheol, going down to the chambers of death. And this can go both ways. So, no sexual allurement. Don't allow yourself to be allured. Oh, this is happening. I know this is happening in people's hearts and minds all across this room tonight. You know it's happening. Don't do it. You're like an ox going to the slaughter. No sexual allurement. Keep going here. No sexual looking or touching outside of marriage. Job 31, I've made a covenant with my eyes. What a great picture. And you're in covenant with your eyes not to look at another woman. So don't look at someone else sexually who's not your husband or your wife. And this is not even just lusting. This can involve taking advantage of another person when you're able to see something private that you should not see. That's exactly what happened with Ham and Noah in Genesis chapter 9. And then it pertains to what you touch. The Bible prohibits touching in any way that you would not normally touch your friend or a family member, in any way that's sexual in nature. Deuteronomy chapter 25, put it there. The law punishes a woman who grabs a guy in the crotch to help her husband when he's in a fight. That's not permissible. You just mark it down. The crotch is off limits outside of marriage. Doesn't matter what's at stake. No sexual looking or touching. And finally, no entertaining ourselves with or joking around about sex outside of marriage. And this is huge. Ephesians 5, verse 3. Listen to this passage. Sexual immorality and all impurity or covetousness must not even be named among you, as is proper among saints. Let there be no filthiness, nor foolish talk, nor crude joking, which are out of place. It goes on to say, it is shameful even to speak of the things that they do in secret. Now, the reason this is so huge is because in our culture, even as Christians, even for those who say, okay, I'm not going to indulge myself sexually in these ways, so many of us are entertaining ourselves with those who do indulge themselves sexually in these ways. You say, what do you mean? Well, you think about the books we read, the music we listen to, the movies we pay to watch, the TV shows we turn on. How many of them make light of or even exalt sexual immorality? Movie after movie, song after song. So many songs we listen to, we sing by heart, that are talking about sexual activity outside of marriage. Book after book. Bestsellers like the 50 Shades of Grey series and countless other subtle versions of the same thing that are filling leisure reading among Christians. We read these things. We listen to these things. We watch these things. And it's as if we've said to the world, we're not going to do the things you do, but we will gladly pay money to read about and listen and watch you doing them in front of us. Ephesians 5:3 says, it must not be named among you. It's shameful to even speak of the things they do in secret. Don't miss this. God's standard doesn't just stop with us avoiding these sins, but with us not entertaining ourselves with other sins. Now, I'm not presuming here that just to talk about sexual immorality is sin. That would make this whole sermon a sin. But the key is, we're not talking about sexual immorality in a way that views it as good, but as something we're to avoid. And so much of what we're exposing our eyes and our minds to, and so much of what we're exposing our kids' eyes and kids' minds to, is dulling our spiritual senses to the point where we see sexual immorality as not that bad. In the end, actually kind of entertaining to us. When it should not be, we should grieve over it and run from it. If you were in a room where a couple was making out on a couch, would you sit down in the seat next to them and just watch? You say, of course not. That's weird. It is weird. Then why is it acceptable for you to do the exact same thing as long as that couple's on a TV or a movie screen the size of a 3-story building in front of you? This should not be. God's word prohibits entertaining ourselves with or joking around about sex outside of marriage. Now, I want to be careful in all this, and all these prohibitions, don't do this, don't do that. I want to be careful not to communicate. The Bible gives an entirely negative picture of sex. On the contrary, it doesn't. The Bible celebrates sex as good, as something designed by God for our good. You just You think about it. God made man and woman in the way he did in the first place for a reason. God made the body for sexual pleasure. One preacher said it wasn't like God made the man, made the woman, went and got a ham sandwich, came back and was like, what in the world is going on down there? Oh my goodness, I can't believe it. Look at this craziness. I never thought they'd do that. Wow, where'd they come up with that? You look at the parts, and it seems to be what the plan was. God created the body for pleasure, for sex, to be enjoyed in marriage. Sex is good. The body is good. Nudity is good, providing it's all in the context of marriage. That's the key. You look back at all these prohibitions, and what unites them is the Bible prohibits sexual activity outside of marriage because God has designed sexual activity for marriage. So don't get the wrong idea here. Sex isn't bad. Sex is good. It's great within the boundaries that God has designed it for. Now, it's at this point that people start identifying gray areas. Well, what about this or what about that? And there's tons we can dive into, but I put three common practical questions here that I want to serve you with in the Word as we talk about sexual immorality. Questions like, how far is too far between a single man and a single woman? And it's questions like these where we start looking for specific Bible verses, and when we don't find one, we conclude, well, I guess I just have to figure this one out on my own. And that's exactly what we've done with this question in the church in a way that I'm convinced has been disastrous for teenagers and single men and women all across the church. I would even go so far as to say that the lack of an objective biblical answer to this question has been disastrous in my life. So I want to be completely honest with you tonight about this question in my life. Before I got married, particularly in high school and college, I had who knows how many conversations with friends and church leaders about this question. And I cannot ever remember hearing a well-reasoned, objective, biblical answer to this question. Instead, what I heard over and over and over again went something like this. People would say, well, clearly no sex outside of marriage. The Bible prohibits that. But after that, the Bible doesn't give specifics. So you need to pray and set some boundaries. Basically, build your own list of sexual standards that you're going to live by. And so I and my Christian buddies would sit around. We'd talk about what those standards should be. We all came up with different answers. Some guys saying kissing was okay. Other guys saying as long as clothes stayed on, it was okay. In reality, the guy with the lowest standards would usually win out in the discussion. You put a bunch of young guys together who are sexual sinners, what else are you going to expect? And so this is an area where, quite honestly, I struggled. I struggled to set boundaries, and I struggled to keep boundaries. And I found myself in this dangerous gray area that led to all sorts of confusion and guilt and failure. By God's grace, both Heather and I had never had sex with each other or anybody else before we were married, but that did not mean we had glorified God with our bodies. And I share all that to say that I remember well what this struggle was like. And I want to say tonight what I wish somebody had said to me. Maybe somebody said it and I just wasn't listening, but I want to urge you to listen tonight. I want to show you what I believe is a biblical, objective answer to this question. And I'll go ahead and warn you that many of you are going to think it's extreme, restrictive even, and many of you will be likely tempted to think, well, that's easy for you to say since you're married now. But I'm saying this out of a heart of hurt from past sin, out of a desire for your good, and ultimately out of the overflow of what Scripture teaches. So I want you to follow this with me. And I'm indebted here to a good book on this issue called Sex, Dating, and Relationship by pastors Gerald Heistand and Jay Thomas. They observed, just listen to this, they observed 42% of single evangelicals, so single Christians, Bible-believing Christians, 42% between the ages of 18 and 29 are currently in a sexual relationship. 22% have had sex in the past year, and an additional 10% have had sex at least once. Assuming the accuracy of that data, this means only 20% of young Bible-believing Christians have remained abstinent. And continue on saying, the pastoral community must shoulder much of the blame here. Simply put, we pastors are not quite certain how to counsel singles and teens regarding appropriate sexual boundaries. We either offer subjective biblical standards, the Bible says be pure, which can be massaged around like a wax nose, or objective personal opinions, keep it above the neck, which lack any real authority. Singles need an objective biblical standard of premarital sexual ethics, and we pastors are the ones responsible for providing it. So I want to provide it. Here goes. The Bible gives us three God-ordained categories for relationships between men and women. When you look at relationships in the Bible, there are only three categories. And all three categories had God-given standards for sexual activity in them. So first, you've got the neighbor relationship, your relationship with your neighbor, where sexual activity is prohibited. Jesus teaches us to love our neighbor. It's the people around us. Could be our literal neighbor, friend, co-worker, whatever. We're to love our neighbors as we love ourselves. And in that relationship, we see all over Scripture that sexual activity is prohibited. The Bible never celebrates in any way sexual activity between neighbors, i.e. between a man and a woman who are not married. And the reason I put 1 Corinthians chapter 7 in parentheses there is because that's what the Bible says. We're going to look at this starting next week. The Bible says, if you have a strong sexual desire, then get married. Bible doesn't say experiment with your neighbor and then decide whether or not you're going to get married. Bible says if you've got a sexual desire that needs to be fulfilled, get married. In chapter 1, you look in chapter 7, verse 1, the Bible's clear. It is good for a man not to have sexual relations with a woman. In other words, it's good for a man not to have sexual relations with a woman in this neighbor relationship. So that's the neighbor relationship. Sexual activity prohibited there. Then second, there's the family relationship, which would include brothers and sisters, mothers and fathers, children. And again here, sexual activity is prohibited. We've talked about this. The Bible forbids sexual activity with members of your family, apart from your husband or your wife. Which then leads to the third God-ordained category of relationship, the marriage relationship between a man and a woman. And there, sexual activity is commanded. In the first few verses of 1 Corinthians 7, the Bible commands a husband and a wife to engage in sexual activity together because that sexual union is a sign of the covenant relationship that they have before God. So it's commanded there. Now you put all that together and you realize, so follow this. God, in his word, has no category for two people who aren't married but kind of, sort of, in some ways act like they are, particularly sexually. That is not a God-ordained category of relationship. There is not one place in this entire book where we are ever encouraged to engage in any sexual activity outside of the marriage relationship. Instead, we're discouraged. Remember the whole definition of porneia. Sexual immorality is sexual activity outside of marriage between a man and a woman. We talked about how it's the kind of thing that you would be outraged to find your spouse doing with someone else. I would be furious if another guy hugged my wife sexually, kissed my wife sexually, or touched my wife sexually in any way. Yet many single Christian guys have no problem doing any or all of those things with a woman who's not their wife. Which leads me to ask the question, would it be acceptable for me as a married man to kiss a woman who's not my wife, to do these things with a woman who's not my wife? You say, of course not. But the reality is, guys, any single woman that you're talking with statistically is likely going to be somebody's wife. So why should you be doing these things with somebody else's wife? You say, well, she might be my wife, or I think she's going to be my wife. And the Bible says, well, then make her your wife and then kiss her all you want. But apart from that, 1 Corinthians 7, it is not good for a man to have sexual activity with a woman. She's your neighbor. And sexual activity is prohibited with your neighbor. And then you take this a step further because Scripture takes it a step further. And you look, I put in parentheses 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 1 and 2, because Paul says to Timothy there to treat older women as mothers and younger women as sisters in all purity. So follow this. The Bible ties pure treatment of the opposite sex with the picture of the family relationship. So, singleness, single men and women, what does purity look like with your brother or your sister? Guys, would you make out with your sister? Would you passionately kiss your sister? You say, absolutely not, no way. Why not? Because she's my sister. Precisely. There you have it, a standard for purity in your relationship with a single woman in Christ. Absolutely nothing sexual. No way. Why not? Because she's my sister. And certainly your sister in Christ, or single women, your brother in Christ, deserves all the greater purity in Christ than even your own family member does. And so I want to encourage you, single men, single women in this room, based on the three God-ordained categories of relationship in the Bible, I want to encourage you not to do anything sexually with another person who's not your husband or your wife. You're looking for a general guideline? What's the line? Here it is. Don't do anything that you wouldn't do with your brother or your sister. Because any and all sexual activity is for marriage. These three God-ordained categories of relationship lead to one inevitable God-glorifying conclusion. Regardless of whether you are single or married, flee any and all sexual activity outside of marriage. And I'm convinced that this is exactly how people in the first century would have heard these commands in 1 Corinthians 6 and 1 Thessalonians 4. And this is why the biblical authors never felt a need to spell out how far is too far. They'd already spelled it out. Flee porneia. Flee sexual activity outside of marriage between a man and a woman. And I don't want to pause here and just commend couples that I know in this faith family who have had the courage to do this. Some couples who are moving toward marriage right now, other couples who are now married and throughout their time of dating or courtship and then engagement treated one another as brothers and sisters in Christ. They didn't engage in any sexual activity that they wouldn't do with their brother or sister before they were married. It can be done, and it will glorify God according to his good design when it is done. Mark it down. I've never talked with a Christian couple that regretted all they didn't do before they were married. I have talked with innumerable couples with deep scars over what they regretted doing before they were married. Please hear this. I challenge you tonight. Single men of God, single women of God, by the grace of God in Christ, honor your brothers and sisters in Christ in a way that is totally otherworldly, completely courageous, and Christ honoring, which is the point, right? Like, why would we ask the question in the first place, how can I get close to sin without actually sinning? How can I glorify God most with my body? And I don't see biblically how we would come to any other conclusion than this. And pray that the Lord will give you ears to hear and grace to obey. Well, then some might think, what am I to do with these sexual desires, these sexual urges? All this is just complicated by the fact that people are waiting longer and longer to be married. At the same time, when God has designed our sexual desires to take effect, we're prolonging the avenue he's designed for them to take effect in. So some people think, what do I do with these urges? Which leads to this question, what about masturbation? And the ironic thing is, it's single men who will often say, well, I have a need to do this because I'm not married. But the reality is, hear this, research shows that 70% of married men continue to masturbate. So this is by no means exclusively a single issue. And it's not exclusively a male issue either. Increasing numbers of women engaging in masturbation, self-stimulated sex. Now, again, some Christians think, well, the Bible doesn't anywhere speak directly against it, so maybe it's okay, or maybe even good. But just because the Bible doesn't address something specifically doesn't mean it doesn't say anything at all. I'm convinced that Scripture speaks clearly to this. Is masturbation glorifying to God? Well, think about God's good design for sex, all that we've seen in God's Word, and you realize that masturbation goes completely against God's design at every level. You think about it. God designed sex to be relational, but masturbation is lustful. Sex is designed to be experienced in a relationship with a husband or wife, not with you sitting alone thinking about somebody who's not your husband or your wife. This is huge. Masturbation, by its very nature, necessitates sexual desire. It's got to be desire there. And if you're not desiring in that moment your husband or your wife, then your desires are wrong. If you are desiring your husband or your wife, then 1 Corinthians 7 says, go to your husband or your wife to fulfill that desire. God has designed sex to be relational. Masturbation is not. Similarly, God designed sex to be covenantal, but masturbation is totally non-committal. Sex meant to bind a man and a woman in a committed covenant relationship. It's the sign of the covenant, right? But masturbation completely perverts this covenant-making, covenant-celebrating, covenant-renewing design because it involves commitment to no one else but yourself. It's non-committal. God designed sex to be intimate. Masturbation is superficial. It is shallow at best, not at all reflecting the intimate union that God has designed for sex. God designed sex to be selfless, or God designed sex to be fruitful. Masturbation is fruitless. It doesn't lead to child rearing, doesn't lead to faith building, doesn't lead to relationship growing. It's fruitless. God designed sex to be selfless. Masturbation is self-centered. It's designed to satisfy yourself, not another, which goes completely against God's design for sex. Which is why, on a side note here, marriage does not solve the problem of masturbation. Because masturbation, for many people, men and women, married men and women included, is easier than sex with your spouse because it's not really about sex at all. It's just about your desire to satisfy yourself rather than give yourself to satisfy someone else, which is God's design for sex. Masturbation is completely self-centered. God designed sex as a complex union. Masturbation involves personal isolation. Masturbation is the complete opposite of what happens when two minds, two bodies, two souls come together in sex. Individual isolation instead of complex union. And here's the danger. Masturbation teaches people. This is another reason why it continues in a marriage, because it teaches people to mentally, physically, emotionally satisfy themselves apart from a husband or a wife in a way that goes against God's good design. Finally, God designed sex as a complementary heterosexual act, but masturbation is a personal homosexual act. A male being aroused by a male, a female being aroused by a female, same-sex arousal, same-sex fulfillment. You say, no, it's not. Absolutely it is. Just because you imagine a heterosexual relationship, which we've already seen, is wrong, does not make this a heterosexual reality. It is personal homosexuality. And so we'd be wise to heed the words of Romans 13, 14. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. Final question I want us to dive into. How do I fight pornography? And I have struggled with how to best address this. We know, Christians, we know that pornography is wrong. Yet statistics continue to show that approximately half of the men in any church and increasing numbers of women are at some level addicted to pornography or engaged in pornography. And so I know in three worship gatherings today, looking out across this, I know that pornography right now in hearts and lives of men and women in this room is damaging souls who are sitting before me. And it's destroying relationships and it's ruining marriages in this room. Even if you think you're hiding it, it's kind of underneath the surface. It's ruining marriages and it's crippling the church. It's crippling the church today. I have talked before about the number of younger women who are going to the mission field that far exceeds the number of young men who are going. And I'm convinced one of the reasons, and I can't prove this, I'm not saying it's the only reason, but I'm convinced one of the reasons why so many men are not taking hard assignments for Christ around the world is because pornography has such a grip on their minds and their souls, and they're weak. And I want to pastor a church of strong men and women who are victorious in a battle with pornography, then freeze them up to fight battles for the souls of people in Birmingham and Muslims and Hindus and Buddhists around the world. So how does that happen? And I don't think my words tonight are sufficient to make you stop going to pornography, but I believe God's word and the gospel are sufficient. So you've got an insert in your worship guide, and I wanted you to have this as a resource, truth, that just simply spells out 10 gospel exhortations. What I've done is took the five threads of the gospel and just applied those truths, each thread, to two particular truths, exhortations that I want to give you. I've listed scriptures in parentheses there and then put one passage on there. I'm not going to do a lot of explanation here. You make notes on there if you want, but I really just want the gospel and God's word to be clear. I pray in a way that speaks to the hearts of men and women all across this room right now who are fighting battles with pornography. And I use that word intentionally. This is a battle. 1 Peter 2:11. I urge you as sojourners and exiles to abstain from the passions of the flesh which wage war against your soul. 2 Corinthians 10, we walk in the flesh, we are not waging war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but have divine power to destroy strongholds. This is a battle. This is a fight. So this is not an easy answer. Like, this is a battle. This is war. And we won't get even to fight in the battle if we just try to hide it. And it's a hidden sin in so many lives, so many pastors' lives. I read over half of pastors say they've visited pornographic sites on the internet sometime in the last year. Almost one in three have done so in the last month. And I share those statistics with you with trembling. By God's grace, and only by God's grace, I do not have anything to do with pornography in my life, internet or otherwise. But I read those statistics, and they just scream at me, take heed lest you fall. And so lest anybody think, okay, well, I'm glad to speak to somebody like this is for all of us. So I want to exhort us. It's a battle, huge battle in our day. So first, based upon the character of God, brothers and sisters, number one, cultivate unshakable zeal for the glory of God's name. Pray like this every morning. All day long and at night, pray like this. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. My Father in heaven, cause your name to be hallowed in my life. Cause your name to be hallowed in my eyes. Cause your name to be hallowed in my desires. I want your will to be done in my life and what I do today, what I look at like it is in heaven. Cultivate unending, unshakable zeal. Do we want the glory of God's name? Do you want the glory of God's name? Long for the glory of God's name more than you long for that image. Cultivate in your heart unshakable, unending zeal for the glory of God's name. Second, acknowledge your sexual drive as a good gift from a gracious God. So it will not help us to leave truth behind and just try to make ourselves think that all sex is bad. We've seen already, Genesis 2:24, sex is good. We're designed as sexual beings. Now, God doesn't call everyone to marry. He gives grace for many to control this area in a life of God-glorifying singleness. But the reality is we're hardwired this way with sexual desires that God has created for our good. We are sexual beings. The problem is we're also sinful beings, which leads to the second gospel thread, exhortation number three, run. Knowing that we're sinful sexual beings, run. Don't reason with, don't rationalize. Run from every temptation. Any temptation, knowing that one sin is enough to warrant infinite damnation. Flee from sexual immorality. So don't buy the idea, this is no big deal. It's just once. This is a huge deal. It's a huge deal, just once, huge deal. They ate a piece of fruit in Genesis 3. They took a bite of a piece of fruit, that's all they did. And from that one sin came condemnation for all men, Romans 5. All the effects of sin and all the suffering we see in the world today around us came from one little sin. So run from any temptation. That's why this word flee, run. Knowing that one sin is enough to warrant infinite damnation. See the severity of sin. And guard yourself with godly friendships and gospel accountability. We are sinful. We need each other. So take care, brothers, lest there be in any of you an evil, unbelieving heart leading you to fall away from the living God. But exhort one another every day, as long as it's called today. It's today, exhort one another, that none of you may be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. We know that so much of the power of sin is found in its secrecy, right? So as long as you can hide it, you continue to indulge in it. So be in relationship with brothers or sisters of the same sex. I meet every week with a couple of pastors, and we walk through specific questions in each other's lives. I need those brothers to guard me from myself. We need brothers and sisters to guard us from ourselves. This is why we say over and over again, get involved in a small group. Not just check off the box small group, but some people who you're walking through life with, who know your besetting sins, and who are given good gospel-saturated accountability in this, who are spurring you on toward Christ, Hebrews 10. Which leads to the next thread, character of Christ. Contemplate the price Christ paid for your purity. See him writhing on a cross in agony. Fight tempting images with that image. See him, not them. When you're tempted to look at them, look at him. That's the whole point of 1 Corinthians 6, 15, and 17. You see the crucified Christ in front of you, with you, when you're looking at the computer screen. Realize that the crucified Christ is united to you as you look at that. And he paid a price, an infinitely dear price, to purify you and free you from this. So, fight those images with this image. And consider the compassion Christ has for the souls of men and women. Love and pray for them. Don't exploit and abuse them. Women and men in pictures are people. They're people. They're people. That woman you're looking at, that man you're looking at, this is somebody's daughter. There's some parents who are weeping over what you're looking at their daughter doing. I think your daughter, son, these are not objects. These are souls. So love and pray for them. Don't exploit and abuse them. When Jesus saw the crowds, he had compassion on them. They were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. These women, these men, and these images need you to point them to Christ, not to fuel their exploitation. Their eternity is at stake. Consider the price Christ paid for your purity and the compassion Christ has for their souls. Fourth component of the gospel, the necessity of faith. Oh, believe that God is for you and that he knows what is best for you. So in calling you away from pornography, God's not calling you away from good. He's calling you away for your good. He knows what's best for you. Believe this. Taste and see the Lord's good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. Fear the Lord, you his saints. For those who fear him have no lack. The young lions suffer want and hunger. But those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. God's promised to give us everything we need. Everything our souls truly desire. Believe this. Believe this. God is for you. He knows what's best for you. Like if you think, well, I'm doing this because I've got such a great desire in me. No, your desires are weak. It takes so little to satisfy you. You want real fulfillment? Go to God. He's satisfying. You taste and see he's good, then you get a little taste of that, you spit it out of your mouth. He's nowhere near as good as he is. Believe this. He's good. So how do you grow to trust him as good? You memorize and meditate on Scripture. You fight the fight of faith with the weapon of the Word. How can a young man keep his way pure? By guarding it according to your Word. With my whole heart I seek you. Let me not wander from your commandments. I've stored up your Word in my heart that I might not sin against you. So memorize these Scriptures. Meditate on them. Hide, lodge the Word deep within your heart. You are powerless without the Word and the Spirit in this battle. You take up the shield of faith and the sword of the Spirit to fight the flaming arrows of the evil one. And don't give up. Persevere. Don't give up. Press on in light of the urgency of eternity. The stakes in this battle are high, brothers and sisters. They're high. They're eternally high. So ponder the eternal danger and destruction associated with sexual sin. Jesus, you've heard that it's said, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you, everyone who looks at a woman with lustful intent has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. It's better for you to lose one of your members than your whole body be thrown into hell. If your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off, throw it away. It's better for you to lose one of your members than your whole body go into hell. That's Jesus in the first book of the New Testament. In the New Testament, the word says, blessed are those who wash their robes so they may have the right to the tree of life. Enter the city by its gates. Outside are the sexually immoral and murderers and idolaters and everyone who loves and practices falsehood. Oh, don't be counted among them, men. Women, don't be counted among them. This is not a game. Ponder the eternal danger and destruction associated with sexual sin. It damns. It damns. It damns. And last exhortation, best exhortation, in light of the urgency of eternity, ponder the eternal delight and joy associated with future salvation. You've been saved to delight in God. One day in a delight that will be complete and full. So be patient for that day. Long and look forward to that day when a great multitude like the roar of many waters, like the sound of mighty peals of thunder, will cry out, "Hallelujah! For the Lord our God, the Almighty, reigns. Let us rejoice and exult and give him the glory. For the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. It was granted her to clothe herself with fine linen, bright and pure. For the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints." I urge you, be found in Christ on that day. All of this leading to three final gospel exhortations back in your notes. Where does all of this leave us? All we've talked about this week and last week. Here's where it leaves us. Three exhortations. One, I invite you, I urge you, I plead with you based on the love and mercy of Christ. Repent of and run from any and all sexual activity outside of marriage. So I ask you, I ask every person sitting in this room, in what ways are you indulging in sexual activity outside of marriage? I have had to repent in different ways in response to these 2 weeks, and I want to call you tonight to repent. I want you to see the mercy of God in bringing you to hear his word tonight. And I want to call you to repent. Maybe it's adultery. Maybe it's allurement, flirting with this man or that woman. Maybe it's immodesty. Maybe it's lust. Maybe it's the entertainment you're exposing yourself to. Maybe it's sexual activity of any sort with a single sister or brother in Christ. Maybe it's homosexual activity. Regardless, men and women, brothers and sisters, what do you need to repent of? What do you need to run from? In just a moment, we're going to celebrate the Lord's Supper, and I want to invite you to repent in your heart of any and all sexual activity of any sort outside of marriage. At the same time, I want to urge you to rejoice in and run to sexual activity in marriage. So 1 Corinthians 7, if you're single and you can't exercise self-control, then get married. Run to marriage. And I'm not saying run to marriage so you can have sex. You're like saying run to become a Christian so you can get baptized over here. It's cool. No, I'm saying run to a covenantal commitment to leave your father and mother, hold fast your wife or your husband, and then celebrate that covenant with the sign of sex. We'll talk about that more in the coming weeks. And if you're married, run to sexual activity in marriage. 1 Corinthians 7 is clear. This is a command. Married men and women, your bodies don't just belong to you. So husbands, have sex with your wife. Like you got to, this is every Christian married man's dream verse. You got a verse. Right? You sit down with your wife. I really think we need to obey the Bible more. And I came across this verse. We need, and this is radical, we need to do this. You got a verse. So one preacher said, this is where we put the fun back in fundamentalism. Like, we take a literal approach to Scripture here, and it's a good thing. So you got a verse. And ladies, you got a verse too. So you got a verse too. When your husband comes home, and you say, well, I want you to just cuddle with me. And husbands, you're like, cuddle? I don't want to cuddle. And women, you got a verse that says, well, actually, your body belongs to me, and so your body does whatever I want it to do. So my body's saying, I want to cuddle with you, so you got a verse, so lean on your verse. Cuddle. The best defense is a good offense here, right? So wives, you want to guard your husband's thoughts? Give him something to think about, like, all day long. So the Bible, make it hard for him to work thinking about what's coming. So the Bible's telling you to do. Husband, You want to guard your wife's affections, keep your wife's affections, then you cuddle up with your wife whenever she wants. You say, here's my body, what do you want me to do? I remember when I preached an overview of the Song of Solomon one Sunday, and after our first worship gathering, an older couple comes up to me, all smiles, and they said, Pastor, that was a great sermon. We are not even staying for small group. We're going right home. like poking my mind's eye out. Like, oh. That's what I want to call you to do, though. Like, get home quick, married men and women. Rejoice and run to sexual activity in marriage. And then, finally, I know enough to realize that I'm speaking to a whole host of people who have fallen short of God's standards for sexuality in your life. Most of us, likely in many ways. And many of you are likely wondering if you're ever going to have victory in this area of your life. And I know enough to realize that there are others in this room who have been hurt deeply by sexual sin that someone committed against you in a way that's affected you. And you're wondering if you're ever going to heal from that hurt in your life. And so I want to say to every single one of us, regardless of past or present sin, struggles, pain, hurt, I want to invite you tonight to receive and rest in the forgiveness and freedom, hope and healing that are found in Christ alone. Christianity is a religion for those who have blown it, and we've all blown it. But we have a Savior who lived a sinless life as our example. He died a sacrificial death as our substitute in our place. He arose from the dead, and he has sent his Spirit to make us entirely new creations.